The KPFT Community Advisory Board is requesting your participation in a listener survey. The KPFT Community Advisory Board, also known as the CAB, is a vehicle for effective community input to the station's governing body about station programming, community service, and impact on the community from the station's major policy decisions. Community Advisory Boards assist stations in developing programs and policies that address the specific needs of the communities they endeavor to serve. KPFT listeners are welcomed and encouraged to participate in the completion of this survey. Please visit the KPFT website at www.kpft.org and complete the Community Needs Survey. Thank you for your help, and thanks for listening to 90.1 FM KPFT Houston.
Daniel Lopez is a prisoner in Texas. If the state has its way, he'll be dead within the hour. This is Execution Watch. Huntsville, Texas, death penalty capital of the Western world, where prison staff is preparing to put Lopez to death by injecting him with a deliberate drug overdose. During the next hour, KPFT's Execution Watch will broadcast live coverage of the killing in Texas, the state responsible for more than a third of all U.S. executions. Execution Watch host Ray Hill, Chief Legal Analyst Jim Skelton, with legal analysts Susan Ashley, Larry Douglas, Jack Lee, and Mike Gillespie. Huntsville reporter outside the death house, Pat Hartwell. Houston Vigil reporter Jennifer Simmons. Special interview guest, Daniel Lopez himself, or rather, an audio recording of his interview last week with Execution Watch. The Execution Watch for Daniel Lopez begins.
Good evening, this is Ray Hill. I am the host of Execution Watch. If you're tuned in to listen to Susan Dara's wonderful music program, it is being broadcast tonight on the HD3 channel. If you have HD instrument for a radio, you can just flip right over there. If you do not, you can go to the website, www.kpft.org, and you will find that, just like this show, HD3 channel is streamed live on that website. Susan Dara's music selections on Border Radio can be found on HD3 channel here at KPFT in Houston. They're killing Daniel Lopez tonight, and so first thing we usually do is get a report from Huntsville. Could somebody punch me up over there? Hello, Pat, is that you?
Yes, it is. We just watched five people of the media go by. We do know that some of the family came in the building to go over, but they have not crossed the street, so we don't know if they've changed their minds or not. The press, the 20 press people are out there with their cameras facing the building, so I don't think that they're going to walk by themselves. I don't know.
Okay, but the press, a core of the press have gone in with the
Michael Grasnick and all, and the Corpus people. 60 Minutes is here.
Okay,
here they come right now.
The family witnesses. Okay.
Yeah. This is his mother. His mother, and I believe it's his godmother. That I have spoken to before. Let me get them past the press people. Oh, there's a large family.
Okay.
Just a minute, let them cross the street. Yeah, that's the mother and the godmother going out first. And then there's must be the sister. So there's four of them, and the rest of them are TDC personnel.
Okay.
So it appears to me that there's four family members.
Pat, we can tell the listeners that when the witnesses cross the road, be the media witnesses and the family witnesses, that the procedure has begun. He's already strapped down on the gurney, and they already have needles in his veins before the witnesses crossed the road. So this has begun, and I'd like to tell the listeners that while this show is broadcast, they will hear Daniel Lopez in his own words in an interview made by our chief legal analyst, Jim Skelton. So, Pat, thank you very much for your reporting.
Yes, I'll talk to you when the witnesses come out. I would like to say that it has begun to rain.
It's begun to rain
situation.
In Huntsville.
Yes.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay.
And we have Houston Vigilantes. Where are they located? Let's see. And we have Jennifer Simmons. Jennifer, is that you?
Yes, I'm here, Ray.
Well, where is here?
Okay, it's kind of hard to hear you now, but I'm across from the Art Museum here on Main Street.
Okay, you're there at the intersection of Main and...
In Bend,
and
yes.
Bend, yeah.
In front of St. Paul's United Methodist Church with the Art Museum. There are only two of us here today, me and Art. Here, normally we have about 10, but it being summer, several of our regular people are not here today, but that doesn't matter. We'll keep on and we'll vigil just as normal today, even though it's pretty hot. It's not raining here.
Well, that is the nature of vigilance, to be vigil.
That's right. It doesn't matter whether there's one or 50. We'll stand vigil for Mr. Lopez today. We feel he deserves it. Our heart goes out to him and his family and to the police officer and his family, of course.
And you are connected with the Texas Coalition Against the Death Penalty, right?
Yes, the Texas Coalition, TCADP, Coalition Against the Death, to abolish the death penalty. I'm sorry.
Abolish,
it's not
okay.
Against, it's abolish there.
And what's the best way of finding you?
Well, they can go to the website, which is TCADP.org, and you can get in touch there with our Austin office and all of our offices throughout the state of Texas through that website.
Well, I have the sad news of reporting that the witnesses have crossed the road in Huntsville, so this procedure has begun.
Well, I'm very sorry to hear that. My heart goes out to all those incarcerated in this heat, and may someday we not have to stand here.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. And Jim, what happened in this case?
This is kind of a classic example of an old country song about people breaking up. And as the artist said, you'll be somewhere right and I'll be somewhere wrong. Same set of facts, they just look at it differently. What happened, Daniel Lopez was 21 years old. About 12:30 at night, he ran a stop sign. And a police officer saw him and attempted to stop him. Daniel's concerned about several things. Number one, he had a gun in the car. He is worried about the fact he was on deferred and had not reported, worried about an arrest warrant. Plus, he had some drugs in the car. He tells me that the reason the policeman stopped him because someone's had a similar car to his had been messing around with the policeman's girlfriend, and they got into a confrontation over it. Daniel gets out of the car. Policeman says that at this point, that a policeman grabs him like he's going to walk away. Daniel shook him off. They get into a confrontation. Policeman tries to tase him. Ken gets tangled up in the lines, then squirts him with pepper spray. Daniel says he gets in his car and takes off. Cop claims that he didn't hit the eyes. Daniel said he did, because Daniel said he could barely see, and he took off on a high-speed chase. Make a long story short, there was a lot of policemen chasing Daniel, and of course they claim when he tried to ram their cars and try to hit them, he was trying to kill them. He said on the other hand he was simply trying to escape and to avoid them, but they looked at it as trying to kill him. How it culminated is that an officer had put down some spikes in the road on the freeway, stood off to one side of the spikes. Daniel said he swerved, he saw the spikes, swerved to avoid him, couldn't see the police officer because of the pepper spray in his eye, hit and killed the police officer. At that point, the policeman surrounded him. Again, he tried to escape, tried to ram more cars. They interpreted that as them trying to kill him, kill more policemen, is how the state interpreted that. And he just simply said, I was trying to get away. They ended up shooting him through the chest and arm. It was not a critical wound. He survived. And then he got the death sentence based upon that.
And this happened in Nueces County?
It happened in Corpus Christi, Nueces County, around 12:30 at night.
Up there, and how long has he been on the road?
He's been on the road 5 years.
5 years, so he is relatively a newcomer.
Well, as we'll discuss further, he waived all appeals that he could. He said he wanted to get it over with.
And you had an interview with him?
I sure did.
The next thing you're going to hear on Execution Watch tonight is the interview between Jim Skelton and Daniel Lopez. And so are y'all set up, ready to begin the interview? Okay, the interview will begin now.
Okay, Daniel, let me explain what we're doing. My name is Jim Skelton. The gentleman behind us doing the camera work, his name is Mark Pirtle. And the lady back over in the back is Elizabeth Stein. And what we do, we have a program in Houston called Execution Watch. And what we do, we come up and interview people who are on death row who have a scheduled execution. And what we do is we interview them, and the primary purpose behind that is twofold. Number one, we want the public to know that you're a living, breathing human being and that you have some merit. We want them to know that. And number two, we want to give you the opportunity. Is there anything you want to get off your chest, anything you want to say, you're welcome to say it. Because what we're going to do is record this interview on film, we're going to record it on audio, and we're going to play it on the radio. It's not going to be censored. It's going to be completely what you want to say. We're not going to edit any of it. And I trust we have your consent to do all of this.
Of course.
Okay, well, I appreciate that. And I want to know, I really, really appreciate you talking to us. Now, one thing we talked about before we began the interview, one thing that's been very unusual about your case, and I told you at the very beginning, I don't think you belong up here. And the reason I don't think you belong up here is, number one, you were 21 years old when this happened. Number one, what you did was not an intentional act. As you well know, you were simply fleeing from the police. May I understand it, and correct me if I'm in error, they sprayed you with some gas, and you couldn't see, and you hit the officer. Is that pretty well correct?
Yes, they only say it only on the side of my face, but that's not true at all.
What actually happened that you couldn't see the officer?
How did I see him?
Uh-huh.
Well, when I got, do you want me to explain it from the beginning or the end?
Yeah, just
how I got pepper sprayed or how uh-huh. That exact incident with the officer.
Exactly.
Okay, when I got a pepper sprayed is when the police officer pulled me over. For not making a complete stop at a stop sign.
So it was a stop fight, just a traffic violation.
In a way, because that same officer, Sergeant Cox, he was on that beat for the third time, having been called to three blocks down to this residence of some man in a blue truck that was harassing and threatening his girlfriend, wife, or whatever she was to him. And so when he pulled me over, he thought I was that person.
Oh,
that's why.
I see.
That's why. Even though it was a traffic stop too, but when I pulled over, I told him I was gonna get into this gated fence. So you know what I'm saying, just avoid any contact period with the police. But when I got down, I was rounding around my hood. The officer said, come here. And I told myself, you know, they ain't gonna find nothing. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I'm just gonna give me a ticket or whatever, right? And so I turned around. I started walking to him. And when I got in like maybe 3 feet span of him, he reached out and grabbed my shirt and he like tried to throw me to the floor. But you gotta understand, he thought I was this other suspect because I had a dark green expedition, and so when he tried to throw me to the floor, it's natural in my instincts, right? My leg went over his leg and I stopped myself from going to the floor and I pulled back and that's when my whole short turn, and I just swung at him twice, and that's when he like stumbled backwards and he pulled out his
pepper spray?
No, his taser.
Taser.
He put out his taser, and when he told me to get to the floor, and when I was already in fight and flight mode at that time, you know, I'm worried, you know, my shirt's all torn, and I'm just trying to get away now, right? And so when he did that, I went towards him, but I stepped to the left real quick. That's when one prong hit me, and the other one hit the torn shirt. Then that's when I hit him twice more, and that's when his taser fell down, and he was also grabbing for his radio, and that fell down as well. So he stumbled more backwards. So now we're like where the trunk of his cruiser's at, and where his trunk of the cruiser's at, and that's when he put out his mace. And when I hit him twice more, he was arching it already, and so where he was falling, it's like it happened so slow motion. When he was falling, it went right in my eyes. And I'm telling you, he didn't get me on the side; he got me right in my eyes, right. And I already knew, you know, I need some cold air because you know I've been pepper sprayed before, not by the police, but just for to see how it felt like. And so that's when I need cold air. So when he fell down, I walked to my ride. I walked to my ride, got in, turned it on, turned on the AC full blast. Now that's when I took off. And so little by little, it's like I'm crying. It's like a really, really rainy day. Like, you know what I'm saying? All you really see is lights. But it's this really, really day. So when I'm taking off, And I get around the corner. That's when I reach down and I throw out my gun out the window. But when I do that, I see lights right behind me already. And you know how there was already police in the area looking for that other suspect. And so that's when I was the whole time I was trying to escape. And so I'm just basically seeing car lights. And I eventually said, you know, I need to try and get out of that neighborhood. So I was going to try and hit the freeway. But when right before I was going on the freeway, there was a cop car coming up real fast. I'm going like 55 miles, I guess, in the residential area, and the cops are following me, the police cars. And so I'm seeing lights. I'm basically seeing a lot of lights, and I see lights coming up real fast. And so, you know, I know I've seen TV plenty of times. I know I thought they were spike strips, but they're called stop sticks now. But I knew they were stop sticks, and so I swerved away from the police cruiser, and somehow I missed those stop sticks, right? And so when I got on the freeway, the exact same thing. I'm seeing lights, but when I see it coming up real fast, I'm seeing it so late. When I swerve, I basically almost flip. I almost flipped the ride over, but I swerve away from the police cruiser because the three police cruisers were always on the left. And so when I swerved around, at the last minute, I barely missed the stop sticks. I do the same thing the third time, but this time instead of Lieutenant Alexander being where this cruiser is at, he was on the opposite side of the road, and I'm still half blind. You know, all I'm seeing is lights. So at the last minute, I swerve away because I'm trying to beat the stop sticks, and that's when he was on that side. And like at the last minute, I see him. So I swerve back to the left, and that's when I barely clip him with the side, right? So. And that's how that incident
really
went down.
You weren't trying to hurt anybody.
No, I mean, if I was trying to hurt somebody, I mean, I would have kept my gun, right? I mean, it makes sense, wouldn't it?
Of course it makes sense.
But you know, the whole thing, they say I was out trying to hurt as many officers as I can, you know, because they say I swerved and others. I couldn't see, you know. And so, my whole potential was getting away, but it never happened, right? It just escalated, and that's why I'm here. And,
well, Daniel, this is why I think that this should never have been a death penalty case, because there's no intentional act on your part to hurt anybody, and all it was just a simple traffic violation by stopping at a stop sign. It ends up with you being up here. My question is, at trial, you pretty well wanted the jury to convict you and give you the death penalty, and you pretty much say that?
Well, at the beginning, I don't want to really live the rest of my life in prison, but then that's when my counsel said, you know, this ain't a capital case. This is involuntary manslaughter. You're going to get involuntary manslaughter. And so that's when I actually tried helping at that time, but once they found me guilty of capital murder, That's when I lost all hope, right? It's like, you know, why am I going to want to live the rest of my life in prison? Or
but did they give a jury the chance to find you guilty of involuntary manslaughter? Did they get the chance to do that, or is it just straight capital murder?
They had the option. They had the option of capital murder or involuntary manslaughter.
I see.
And so, but they choose the higher one. And
how in the world did they ever prove you intentionally did this? What did they do? Just because it was a policeman? Or?
Well, the DA explained to them, you know, intent can be in the snap of finger. And so they say I intentionally swerved, which is true. I intentionally swerved in that direction. I didn't know he was there, though. But when I seen him at the last minute, I tried swerving away. That's why I barely clipped him. I mean, obviously, I was trying to avoid hitting him, but it just didn't work out that way. And he explained to the jurors, you know, I had that quick thought to kill an officer for some reason, for fun, I guess. And that's how he convinced the jury that I did this on purpose.
But it seems to me, though, that if you intend to hurt somebody, you would have kept the gun and tried to shoot somebody. You didn't shoot anybody.
And my lawyers had brought that up, but, you know, it just went on deaf ears, you know what I'm saying? It's just there's so many officers that testified against just this low-life criminal, and it's kind of hard not to believe the officers. You know, it's natural for us to naturally believe the officers first before they believe the low-life criminal, right? And I understand why I'm here, because if that was one of my people that got killed, I would want the maximum punishment for them too. And so that's why I can see the side of the police officers and the DAs and them putting me here, even though it's not a capital murder case. And so that's I just see it always around. I see how everything's supposed. I see it in different directions. That's how I see everything around here.
So basically, if I understand what you're telling us, is that you wanted the death penalty because your alternative was even more horrible than dying. Is that correct?
Once they found me guilty of capital murder, I just didn't want to fight anymore. I just didn't want to do nothing, so I didn't take the stand. I didn't tell the jurors nothing, and they just found me guilty of capital murder, right? And so I didn't do nothing to make them think. I didn't do nothing to give me capital murder. They gave it to me. There's nothing during that, during after the sentencing. I mean, and at the sentencing stage, I didn't testify to give me capital murder. I didn't tell them nothing. I just let the court system play out, and they gave me capital murder. So I didn't go out my way to give them that. I mean, to get capital murder. I just sat there, you know, and they gave me it. So.
And then during the trial, you pretty well told your lawyers that, didn't you? That you wanted to get the death penalty.
Oh yeah, that's my lawyers. You know, I have confidential relations with them, you know, and so I could tell them basically anything, right? But I still didn't go and tell the jurors this. You know, these are the people that matter, the jurors. So I told my lawyers that, but I didn't do anything. I didn't do anything to persuade the jurors to give me the capital murder.
So you really just did nothing, is what you basically did, as I understand it. Now, after you were convicted, you've also done pretty much the same thing. You've asked the appellate courts to
After I was convicted, yes, that's when I, you know, expedited. My lawyer said, you know, they'll probably kill you within a year or two. And I've been here 5.5 years, so I don't know where he got that information from, but... And I have been expediting it because, you know, I just see it as a waste of time here. Yeah, I just want both sides to move on, you know, both the victim family and my family to move on in life. And I see the only way that they're going to do that if I'm finally gone. And that's why I'm doing this.
Is there anything, and again, this is entirely up to you, is there anything you want to say to anybody or anything you want to feel or anything you'd like to say about your trial, anything you want to say about the conditions you've been in up here and the problems you've had, anything you want to say to anybody? Yeah, but you say yes or no. Sometimes the nod doesn't work real well on the radio because they don't pick up nods, Daniel. I'm sorry.
Not really. If I want to tell my family something, that would be at my last three visits. You know, it would be something personal, not for
absolutely.
The media to
I understand. Explain. That's something you'd rather share with them, not with the public.
Yes.
I think you have a couple of children, don't you?
I have six children, yes.
Six. And how old are they?
My oldest is 12 and my youngest is 5. Going to be 6.
And have you been able to see them or have any contact with them?
I've been having somewhat contact with them, but at the end, my last 3 days, I plan to see them all, but one of them, all but one, yes.
Another thing I wanted to ask you, and if it's something you don't want to talk about, certainly don't do it. I'd read somewhere that when you were younger, that you've also mentioned some of your writing that you consider yourself the black sheep of the family. Is you mean the black sheep of death row or the black sheep of the family?
Well, I meant that I was at odds with everybody here because in here in death row, they see me, they see that I'm letting the system win, or that I'm committing suicide, and I'm committing suicide. Part is that, you know, I've been convicted of this. I might be speeding it up, but it's still my conviction. It's still my sentence, and I'm gonna man up and accept that, and not be scared like these other people back here that are scared to die. And I guess I really can't. I'm manning up with what they can't do, and I ain't gonna have that false hope on appealing too, because, you know, what's it, 2% of people get off death row, and for all them to keep having that false hope, it's a waste of time, because I see people back there with good issues, but they still get no actions in these courts. They just keep throwing them out, and much less I'm going to get them. They got more better action than me, so I'm pretty sure I ain't going to get them. It just, all it would do is just prolong my, I guess, 3 more years. It'd probably give me 3 more years back here if I were to appeal. And which ain't nothing, right? And if I were to stay here 3 more years, I would get more closer and closer to my kids as they grow up, because my youngest is 5, my oldest is 12. And the more I talk to them, the more bond we get. And so within 3 years, it's going to be a lot stronger bond than the bond that we have now, and it's going to be a lot more painful for them.
And also,
they see it as letting the system win. I don't see it as letting the system win, because, you know, the system's here to protect our people, my family, your family that are on the streets. And you know, if it takes 1 or 2, maybe 3 innocent people to get convicted of the death penalty, then I see that as a sacrifice we have to make, because no system is ever going to be perfect. No system's ever going to be perfect. And if it takes just 3 innocent people to convict 97 guilty people, I think it's well worth it. And you know, we gotta accept our faith, accept our paths in life, and just ride with it, right? And that's what I'm doing.
And you've been on death row how long now?
Death row, I've been here for 5 years and 5 months, about 5 years and 5 months.
And how you been treated since you've been here? I know you mentioned conflict with some of the other people on death row.
Well, yeah, there's conflict everywhere with inmates against inmates, but it's it's really back back here. You know, it's livable. I mean, we're in the cell 22 hours most. Well, 5 days out of the week we get 5 days out of the week we get 2 hours out of our cell. So so you know, and we recreate. I have dominoes. I play chess or Scrabble or you know read book. I read a lot of books. And you know, it's we live back here. That's how we live back here. And so there's no. I know some people say that. Oh, it's how do they call it? It's they can't stand living back there because it's not living. I mean, it is living. You know what I'm saying? Us humans can adapt to any situation, and so back here it's been smooth. You know, it's been smooth. You know, it has ups and downs. You always can have your ups and downs all the time, and but it's livable. It's a livable environment back there, and so that's.
How have you been treated by the guards? Have they been decent to you?
Almost all of them are real nice, real caring and nice. But you got the very few that are mean, and so that's when I do get in trouble. At that time, when they show their meanness to me, so and that's when I get gassed or get sent to level for something or whatever.
And do you feel like continuing living like this is death is a better alternative than continue to live next 4 or 5 or 10 years on death row?
Oh, well, I just see this as a waste of time, and I also don't see death as the end. You know what I'm saying? It says in the Bible, you know what I'm saying, we still got a spirit in our spirit world, and that's what I believe in. I'm just hoping I go to heaven, right? Because it was a little too hot.
That was what I was going to ask you next, if you don't mind me asking. What do you think happens when you die? What happens to your, at that point, do you have another existence, do you think?
I think we go get judged, and once we get judged, we either get sent to heaven or hell, right? And hell's a little too hot for me, so I'm hoping to go to heaven.
And you know what strikes me about this? I do a lot of work in this field, as you probably well know, and you're one of the most remarkable people I've met, because it seems to me that, number one, that you've taken responsibility for what happened. You don't want to cause any further suffering of your family or the victim's family. And that's most unusual to me. That shows a great deal of character. And I just hate to see someone like you be taken away.
I see that as if I would have never tried fleeing, the officer would have never died. And so it's partly my fault too, you know. And even though it was never intentional, it's partly my fault. And I'm just, you know, being a man with it. You know, I'm gonna accept my punishment, and I'm ready, right? And I'm not gonna be scared to die. And I'm gonna try my best to go to heaven. And so that I think everybody needs to do that. If they did their crime, they pay their time, right? But you know, I guess people don't want to admit to their faults or learn from their mistakes. And I'm just, like I said, I see things way different than people back here. And so,
how's your family accepted this?
My family, they've been agreeing with me this whole time, but now that it's come to the date, I'm getting all the disagreements. They want me to appeal it, and it's this. They've been asking me to appeal it just 3-4 weeks ago, and never asked to appeal it before. And so I tell them I'm not gonna play with the system like that. You know what I'm saying? We all agree with me at the beginning. Don't change your mind now. This ain't a game. And it's real hard decision, because I know all I got to do is write a letter to the judge asking to appeal, and they're going to appeal it. I mean, they're going to stop my execution. And it's really, really hard, because my family wants that, but I just want everybody to move on. So I'm like stuck in the middle, right? I think it's kind of harder than a regular person being on death row, and their only focus is to appeal or get a stay. And my focus is trying to satisfy my family, also trying to satisfy the victim family. But it's a real difficult decision. It's not easy. You know, people may think it's easy, but it's not at all.
And have you had any contact with the victim's family? Have you contacted them?
I have not. They have not tried to contact. I think they're supposed to try and contact me first. I think that's how it works. I don't know.
Okay.
But they have not tried to contact me. But I heard that, you know, about 4 or 5 months ago, maybe, that they had an article on me on the newspaper, on some news thing, and they had like a response page. You know, we give your response. I don't know what it's called. But they said she was on there and said she still wants me to die, and her son wants me to get executed and suffer or something like that. And so they still had that hate for me, and I understand that.
Is there anything you'd like for them to know? Because you, of course, won't be able to talk to them.
I think they're going to be at the execution chamber. I hope this satisfies them, and I hope they move on with their life, right? I hope this finally gives them closure. That's all I got to say to them.
Okay.
Okie doke. Anything else you'd like to say to anybody else? Well, I know you're going to save your personal things for your family. You have your children going to be up here, I presume. Yes. You'll be able to see them the last few days. And tell me a little bit, one thing I'd like to go into, if you don't mind talking about it. Growing up, there were a couple of instances we talked about earlier. You tried to kill yourself, is that correct?
Yes, at 10 years
Would
old.
Would you mind talking about that?
Yeah, 10 years old, I was for some reason feeling really, really depressed, and I just took pills out at the medicine cabinet. And
Do you recall what you were depressed over? Do you recall what it was all about?
I remember feeling really, really sad at that time, and so that's when I just seen the pills, and I just took a lot of them, and I slept for like 3 days until they sent me to the hospital. And so I remember that time, and there was also another incident where I made a water moccasin by my hand. That was real painful.
You made a water moccasin bite your hand?
Yes. Yeah.
Come on, you gotta be kidding me.
I was actually trying to make it by my neck, but it wouldn't bite my neck, and I like chopped on it.
You're kidding me.
And it bit my hand, and that was very, very painful.
I can't imagine, Daniel. There are a lot of easier ways to kill yourself than having a snake to bite you. Yeah. I mean, come on. And the reason for that was what, Daniel?
Oh, I was mad at somebody, and I've learned all my life. Well,
when the water mocks, you're mad at me.
I should be mad. Yeah, but I was mad at somebody, but I for some reason I've learned instead of hurting others, I just hurt myself, and it's just something that I've always done. You know, when I'm mad at someone, punch something. You know, give me a little bit of pain to soften the anger, and it's just something I've always do. And so I think that's better than hurting someone else. So.
And let's talk about your family a little bit. How many brothers do you have?
How many brothers I got?
Brothers and sisters, right?
Brother and sister, I got a brother and a sister. Then I also got a half brother and half sister, but I haven't seen them in like 18 years, something like that.
I got you.
But my brother and my sister, I see them periodically.
And they've been pretty close with you?
Really, really close. Well, when I was out in the free, I was really close with my brother and sister. But
is he older or younger?
I'm the youngest, so they're both older, and but when I got in here, I lost contact with my brother, and so but my sister always comes and talks to me every now and then.
Is your brother gonna come up to see you, think?
My brother? No, I don't even think he cares. I don't even think my father cares, because he was asked if he wanted to come up see me. He didn't.
I presume you weren't too close to your father growing up.
Actually, we had our ups and downs, but I was the only son that was always there for him. So you know, it kind of hurts a little bit.
Sure.
And he don't want to come and see me for my last visit. But I hope to maybe call him on my last few hours left here.
So you'll have a chance to maybe contact him. How about your mom?
My mom's coming. Yeah, my mom has been here from day start to finish, but she kind of gets depressed and stops riding. But what has helped is I got about 3 years ago, two godmothers of mine came here, and they showed me a lot of love. You know, they helped me out here, and they did things for me that my family should have been doing, but they did themselves, and they accepted me as their godson, and they come visit me every month. And so them two helped me out greatly.
Have you had any more people other than your family who's been in touch with you and close to you?
Just recently, about maybe 3 months ago, one of my baby's mother, she started coming to see me, and you know, she's always wanted to marry me, and now she's trying to marry me, and I agree, because we love each other, greatly, but times a little, the process has changed now of getting married, so now I can't do that no more, right? It takes a long time now, and I don't got enough time.
One thing I'm curious about, and we talked about this a lot with different people, do you think you were the same person now that you were back when you were 21?
Definitely not.
How have you changed?
I think I've gotten more nicer, more calmed down, more mature, and I have a bigger heart now. It's like, I guess that's what maturing gets with. I don't know, but it's just that I'm more nice. I see things in different sides, I'm way different.
You wouldn't want to pull that moccasin trick again, would you, this point in your life, would you?
Yeah. That was very painful.
I think, Daniel, one time getting bit by a snake is more than enough, don't you think so? Is there anything I can do to help you, anything I could do at all? Anybody at the station could help you. Is there anything you want us to do?
Not much, no.
Well, do me a favor. If you want to write us, I will be happy to give you. My name is Jim Skelton. And what we'll do, we'll send you contact information. If there's anything that we can do for you in these last days, or anybody you want us to help contact, we'll do anything we can in the world to make it more pleasant for you, except send you a snake. Now, I'm not going to send you a snake, okay? But anything we can do to help you, everybody, because this group that came up here, we had a long talk about you to begin with. And I said, this is one of the most remarkable young men I've ever met. Because like I said at the very beginning of this conversation, you do not belong up here, in my opinion. And I can't tell you how sad it is to see you in this plight.
It's, you know, it was thrown my way, and it's life, right? I mean, it's not life, it's never going to be fair. And
in the same way with your family, if we can help them in any way, please have them to contact us. They can contact us at the radio station. And all they got to do is contact Execution Watch at the radio station. We'll give you that contact information. We'll drop you a note. And if we can help you or your family, be sure and let us know.
You need to go talk to the ward and tell them, let me get married. Instead of
procrastinating. You'll probably stick a snake on me, Daniel, if I do that. And we'll try to. I don't think we can do that. We'll do the best part of what we can do.
The reason why it's a long process is because they got to take off 10 cents for my books. And that takes like 3 weeks. And I only got a week left now. So it's crazy.
Well, is there anything final thing you want to say before we finish this interview?
No, thank you for the interview. And if my family does see this, you know, I want them to let them know that I love them. And I hope they finally move on in life. And that's what I really, really want for them to move on in life, and also the victim's family. And this hope, so this volunteer execution won't be, voluntarily execution won't be wasted. And so that's all I got to say.
Well, I really thank you very much. I'm very nice talking to you. Now, I hate it that we have to meet under these conditions behind this glass. I really hate that. But we wish you God the very best, okay?
Thank you, baby.
Okay, thank you, Daniel.
God bless.
Well, I just received hand signals from the studio that the witnesses have left the death chamber. The young man that you just got through hearing being interviewed by Jim Skelton is dead. The state of Texas has killed him with a lethal injection. I want to remind you that you're listening to radio station KPFT in Houston. The program is Execution Watch. I'm Ray Hill. If you are tuned in to listen to Susan Darrow's wonderful show, Border Radio, it is now being broadcast on HD3 channel, and you can get there by going to the website, kpft.org, where the HD3 channel, as well as this channel, is streamed live. Jim, that was a remarkable interview.
Yeah, he's a remarkable kid.
Well, you and he went down some interesting trails. The water moccasin thing draws up a big image.
Yeah, it's surprising. I almost fell out of my chair when he told me about it, yeah.
Yeah. That was I think the last person did that was Cleopatra, actually.
I was going to mention that, but I'm not sure he knew who that would have been, okay. So I thought about that. But
did you get it? Well, of course, the listeners to this show will have an opportunity to see a videotape of that interview.
Mm-hmm.
It will be edited into a broadcast version of this whole program by Mark Pirtle, and will be broadcast on Houston Media Source. If you are on the webpage or the Facebook page of executionwatch.org or on our webpage, we will post both an audio tape of the show and the video to that website. Nueces County, grew up there, kid from the barrio.
Yeah. He was just, like I say, the thing that was remarkable about him, the two things that struck me, number one, is that he was more concerned about his family. He didn't want his kiddos to get bonded with him. He thought it'd hurt more if he delayed it. And his emphasis primarily is on making sure his family, his children, would be all right or better shaped than if he died now. And then the fact that he accepted the fact that he did something wrong and he wasn't going to fight it, and he felt very sorry about the victim's family. And as you well know, we've done these shows a lot. And you don't see that often in anybody. You just simply don't see that kind of character. And he's a 21-year-old kid on top of that.
Well, when the incident happened, it was 21.
Right.
And so now he's about 26.
Right.
That's still a kid.
It's still a kid. He's just a young kid.
And listening to him in the interview, just the impression I got from listening to the audio, he's somewhere still between 21 and 26.
Yeah, sure is.
The maturation level doesn't happen a lot on death row, I don't suppose.
No.
And it hasn't been easy for him on death row because he is going in a counterintuitive way to what everybody else. Everybody else says fight, fight, fight.
Right, he has no support from anybody on death row on this, of course. And just his conscience is primarily what he stayed with.
Congratulations on a remarkable interview. I'm sorry.
Well,
it must be tough.
It was remarkable. I'm not remarkable.
Oh, no, no. You are remarkable because you allowed him to explore with us. And we got an exploration of some of who he was and what makes his thinking work. And you're right. He was a remarkable young man. I am interested in this volunteer business. And where do we go from here, Jim?
Larry's going to talk about the law and that part of it.
Yeah, Ray, as Jim correctly pointed out, Daniel Lopez waived all of the appellate rights that he could waive. There's one that he can't waive, and that is the direct appeal. So this is a death penalty case, and whenever there's a death penalty case, you get an automatic direct appeal directly to the highest criminal court in Texas, the Court of Criminal Appeals.
Texas Court of Criminal Appeals.
Right, right. Now, once that's done, as you know, these cases tend to stay in the appellate system for a really long time in terms of the rehearings and the writ of certiorari to the Texas Supreme Court, and then the writs of habeas corpus, both the federal and the state writs. And they can take a long time. Now, those he can waive. And he went about to try to make sure he waived all of them. Now, typically, when you go through the appellate process, you find out a lot more about the defendant. You know, whether he's competent, did he have competent counsel, is he sane, and so forth, enough to be executed. Having waived all of that, then the courts, to make sure that they don't engage in cruel and unusual behavior, their concern is if you're going to waive these, the rights to appeal, are you competent to waive those rights? And his lawyers are continuing an appeal on his behalf despite his request not to do so. And their attitude is, you know, we have the obligation, despite what the law says, that the law can be changed to keep him from doing this. But he is working to have his will carried out by submitting to the court that sentenced him a request that he be executed in an expeditious fashion. And he attached to the letter to the court reports showing that he is both sane and competent, so that he is competent in the doctor's opinion, that the note that he attached, the documents that he attached, to show that he is competent to waive the appeals. Now, as you might suspect, Ray, this is a death penalty case, so his claim that he was just trying to escape notwithstanding, there was a lot of evidence at trial of police officers claiming that he was using the vehicle he was driving as a battering ram to try to run over them, including putting it in reverse several times to run into them. So much so that he was charged with several other cases, too, in terms of attempted capital murder and so forth. The jury, after finding him guilty of capital murder and assessing the death penalty, they maxed him out on everything else. All of the other cases, he got the max. Okay. Now the punishment evidence was pretty horrific too, but in terms of where he is now, his feeling is, however I got here, I'm ready to go. He also has requested that his organs be used for transplant. Now, the drug that's used to kill him actually poisons the organs.
Yeah, it makes that impossible.
So that becomes impossible for them to use those organs. But as of his attitude right now, his position is, it's time for me to go. I'm gonna go ahead and go. And so he's just again, he volunteered.
Jim, my impression from the interview is that he wasn't much help in his original trial either.
Well, he told me primarily after he was found guilty of capital murder, he knew that he'd spend the rest of his life in prison. He knew that was the alternative. And he said, I just didn't want that because I'd been to prison before. And we talked about that earlier prior to the interview. And he told his lawyers then that he wasn't going to do anything to fight. He'd let nature take its course, kind of like, you know, I did something wrong. I'm accepting my responsibility. I'll take the medicine I've got. And he kind of had that mantra sort of thing, I've got to take it like a man. What I did, I'm responsible for a death. I'm going to take it like a man and come, if whatever comes my way, I'll deal with it.
That's some pretty deep some thinking.
For a kid that age, he did that and made that decision at 21. And then I think what really made it more acute, I think, is the more spent time he spent with his family, the more he felt like if he prolonged it, then what would happen, he'd get real close to his kids and hurt them more later.
They would bond.
And that was really what I thought was the most touching thing about this.
Yeah, that's trying to be a responsible father in an irresponsible situation.
Exactly.
Where do we go from here?
We go here where Michael's going to talk about
the difficult time of being an attorney when your client doesn't want your help. It is a very difficult situation to be representing somebody who wants to die. His words that he said are very chilling. He's not afraid of death. He's afraid of life in prison. That's somber. Mm-hmm. He's not afraid of death. He's afraid of life in prison. When he realized he was going to be arrested on his probation revocation, according to his brother, he told his brother he'd do everything he can to avoid going to jail. He told his mother he'd rather die than go to jail. He practiced evasive driving maneuvers getting ready for this day. This man, way before the death of this policeman happened, was not going to go back to jail and was ready to die to avoid going back to jail because he did not want to go back to jail. So what happens when you're an attorney? What if you see a really good defense? What if you think you can make your reputation by beating this case and your client says, I don't want you to? Are you able to, as an attorney, to put your ego behind and let your client have his wishes? This is a difficult thing to do. What you have to do is make sure your client understands the consequence of his actions. Keep in mind, one of the reasons he wanted to die was that he had 4 life sentences. He knew he was going to spend the rest of his life in jail. He knew he killed a cop. He had 4 boys. He did not want them to bond with him and suffer. But more than that, here's a man who had, am I mistaken, he had 6 children, 4 boys, but 6 kids altogether. He never paid child support, but he knew that if he died earlier, that they would get SSI benefits quicker. That if he kept this thing going for 10-plus years, that'd be 10 years of his kids not having any money. But if he went ahead and got it over with, he would be financially supporting his children. That's a really interesting argument. The problem is we as lawyers have to make him see the other side of that. And the way you see the other side of that is get the family members involved. We can't always reach him, but could his mother reach him? Could the mother of his children reach him? Sometimes in life, clients do not want to admit in court in front of their mother and family they did something wrong. One way of getting him to fight the case is to say, to plead guilty, you've got to admit before your mother you did something wrong. Make him want to fight to have this not be his choice. There's many reasons that the boys would need him, even if he's in prison. Is a false sense to believe that I don't want my boys to bond with me because then they'll lose me. There's many lessons you have to teach your boys. especially how many fathers can actually say that they had the mistakes that this man had, the life that this man had, and still was able to find peace and serenity in his heart. That's something he needs to give to his kids. If his kids did not get a chance to bond with him, they wouldn't get the chance to hear his plea of letting him face death like a man, pay for his sins. You have an obligation to your children to teach them. It's a coward's way out, is what I would tell him, to let yourself die so your kids don't bond with you. You've got a duty to bond with them. You've got a duty to teach them. And that's
what
Mike, I
would have done. But I have a lawyer friend who, like me, recently had a little bout with their mortality. And I recall my lawyer friend being pretty stoic about that when it was all over and looking at and analyzing it. And I feel a little stoic about my close brush. How far off the base is that?
Well, I'm not sure your friend or you would have been a stoic at 21 when your life was in front of you.
Yeah. That is that other factor. The other thing is, once you actually get in prison, it's just another way to live.
Well, the interesting remarks I thought I heard him make, the opposite of this, is when he made remarks to people saying, if I go to prison, I'm going to be the king of the roost because I killed a cop. I'm going to get respect. So on one hand of his, he was saying that if I'm going to be in jail for life, I'm going to be treated well. That is the opposite of what he went to court that said, I don't want to go to jail for life. I want to die. It shows that he was back and forth on the thought process. And, you know, there's another issue to this that we've kind of brushed upon. I do want to talk about before it's over with, is organ donors. You're right. You can't take there's an argument that you can't poison a man and take his organ. But it strikes me that a man who's sentenced to die should have the right to die the way he wants to die.
Yeah, well, like I accused you of being very Scandinavian. That sounds like something we'd come up with in Norway, if they still kill people in Norway, which they don't.
I have nothing else to say. I feel for this
okay.
Man. I feel for
Jack.
This man.
Okay, well, let me tell you about what we're doing. We have a big flap among our legal team about high-speed chases. I, for one, I don't think you should have high-speed chases for a minor traffic violation because, in fact, we're going to have two dead people over a stop sign.
Yeah.
And Jack, of course, is on a little bit hard-nosed than I am, and I've asked Jack to discuss high-speed chases and mitigating factors, pro or con, why you should have these damn things. I think they're too Hollywood, they're too macho, and they're stupid and minor offenses. Jack, on the other hand, a little more hard-nosed than me, has a little bit different opinion. So,
I think the problem that you have with letting minor traffic violations slide and not conduct a high-speed chases, there's a moral hazard component. If you stop, if you allow people,
what's immoral about running a stop sign?
Oh, I'm sorry. if you allow the first person to run a stop sign and just let him go, well, pretty soon you're going to have everybody. Oh, well, the police don't come after you if you run a stop sign.
But Jack, he pulls his before he stops, and he gets his license plate number, knows who he is, they can go to the next stand and give him a ticket.
Well,
there's no reason to chase him down.
Well,
that's my argument.
With that. Is that, as I see, the problem with that is in somebody like Lopez's case, well, oh, I ran a stop sign, the police came after me for a little bit, but because I sped off, he discontinued the pursuit. Well, obviously the police are now after me, so they go into hiding. And police use traffic stops as a vehicle, as an instrument to catch people who have outstanding criminal warrants and things like that. And I think that if you start letting people go, well, idiots like me will start.
I didn't say let them go. I said do another alternative.
Do you mind if I put this in the vernacular?
Go ahead and do it, Greg. Join this argument Jack and I are having.
Listen, I have comforted too many surviving mothers and spouses. If you want to get killed, rabbit from the cops. Because their adrenaline gets flowing. They burn up a lot of gasoline, and the more gasoline they burn, the higher their adrenaline. And by the time they curb you, they are so stoned on their natural juices that they're going to put 51 holes in your body. I mean, it is a dead cinch. You know, if you want to, I violate the law on purpose pretty regularly. First thing you do after you violate the law and you know you're going to get arrested, get real limp and do everything the man says, because you may beat the case when you get to court, but you can't talk your way, a job on your way out of the ass whooping you're going to get on the way to the court, or maybe the getting shot.
Have a tag on your big toe.
Absolutely. I've got to close this thing down. This has been a remarkable edition of Execution Watch. My name is Ray Hill. I host this. I couldn't do it without the excellent work of Elizabeth Stein, our producer. In the studio, I have the legal team. I have Jim Skelton. Susan's here. She's been put on waivers tonight. Larry Douglas is here. Michael Gillespie, Jack Lee. This show would not exist without those voices and those minds. I want to thank Pat Hartwell for covering us in Huntsville and reporting the crossings of the road. I want to thank Jennifer Simmons for reporting from the Houston demonstration. There is a scheduled execution on August the 26th of a Nicaraguan by the name of Bernardo Tercero. If we do not get a stay, we will do an execution watch. Robert Gardner was one of those who are flipping the switches tonight, but he wasn't alone. We've added that staff and built up because we needed the security of having a good staff. Otis McClay is our technical director, and give me a name. Janan is out there doing, okay, she's doing the flipping of the switches, actually, but Robert is there so that we have a continuing staff. Daniel Lopez is dead. If you want to pray for somebody, pray for his kids and his mother and his godmother. If you really want to pray for something, pray that the state of Texas and every other state that still kills people will stop doing so. Victoria Panetti is pouring her soul out for her brother who sits on death row right now in Texas. My name is Ray Hill. Execution Watch signs off for this evening. Thank you.